गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
ओके गुड
गुड
मॉर्निंग.
मॉर्निंग मैम।
यस गुड मॉर्निंग डियर. ओके सो वी विल कंटिन्यू विद द चैप्टर.
गुड मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग. अटेम्प्ट्स टू सिविलाइज एंड एजुकेट द नेटिव. ऑल राइट. सो वी हैव डन द इंट्रोडक्शन, द ओरिएंटलिस एंड द एंग्लिसिस. सो टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट विद द वुड्स डिस्पैच ऑफ 1854. राइट.
यस मैम.
ओके. डू यू ऑल हैव योर बुक्स विथ यू?
यस
यस
मैम.
मैम।
ओके.
यस मैम.
ऑल राइट. ओके. नाउ इन 1854 सर चार्ल्स वुड्स ही प्रिपेयर हिज डिस्पैच सेट ऑफ प्रोविजंस रूल्स ऑन द स्कीम ऑफ व्हाट द एजुकेशन सिस्टम ऑफ इंडिया शुड बी लाइक इन फ्यूचर. नाउ वुड्स एजुकेशन डिस्पैच, सो आफ्टर दैट इट फॉर्म द बेसिस ऑफ द एजुकेशन पॉलिसी ऑफ ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी गवर्नमेंट इन इंडिया सिंस 1854. सो आफ्टर द वुड्स डिस्पैच केम इट वॉज मेड एज द बेसिस ऑफ द होल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी इन इंडिया. नाउ द डिस्पैच वॉज फॉरवर्डेड टू द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया एंड इट वॉज फॉरवर्डेड सो दैट अ प्रॉपर सिस्टम ऑफ एजुकेशन फ्रॉम द प्राइमरी टिल द यूनिवर्सिटी लेवल इट कुड बी फॉर्म्ड प्रॉपरली. सो इट इज़ ऑफन डिस्क्राइब्ड एज द मैग्ना कार्टा ऑफ मॉडर्न एजुकेशन इन इंडिया और द मेन डॉक्यूमेंट ऑलराइट ऑन विच द होल एजुकेशन सिस्टम इज बेस्ड इन इंडिया. एंड इट इज़ सेट टू बी वन ऑफ द वाइजेस्ट स्टेट पेपर्स विच वर प्रिपेयर्ड बाय द कोर्ट ऑफ डायरेक्टर्स और विच वर प्रिपेयर्ड बाय द ब्रिटिश ऑफिशियल्स वाइल दे वर रूलिंग इन इंडिया. नाउ इट इज़ सेट टू बी इन डीड अ लैंडमार्क इन द हिस्ट्री ऑफ एजुकेशन इन मॉडर्न इंडिया एंड इट प्रजेंटेड सच अ प्रॉपर प्लान फॉर द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ एजुकेशनल प्लानिंग एंड एजुकेशन सिस्टम इन द सब कॉन्टिनेंट. सो इट वॉज नॉट ओनली दैट वॉट इट सेड वॉज फॉलोड अंडर द ब्रिटिश रूल बट लेटर ऑन ऑल्सो इट कंटिन्यूज टू गाइड द एजुकेशन डिपार्टमेंट. नाउ एक्सेप्टिंग सो अकॉर्डिंग टू द वुड्स डिस्पैच दे एक्सेप्टेड दैट द इम्प्रूवमेंट एंड वाइडर एक्सटेंशन. सो दे स्टूड फॉर द इम्प्रूवमेंट एंड द एक्सटेंशन ऑफ एजुकेशन. नाउ बोथ एजुकेशन नॉट ओनली इंग्लिश बट ऑल्सो द वर्नैकुलर ऑल द लोकल लैंग्वेज ऑफ द पीपल. एंड दे सेड दैट इट वॉज द ड्यूटी द सेक्रेट ड्यूटी ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया टू प्रमोट बोथ the English as well as the vernacular languages and they recommended following measures to do so. Let's see what those were. Now first is the establishment of a separate department, means the education should be treated and dealt with by a separate department in the government, and so a separate department of education was formed. Then the foundation it also said that universities should be formed in all the three presidency towns. What were the three presidency towns under the British?
Ma'am, Calcutta towns, ma'am.
Calcutta was one of the presidency towns. What were two more? They were also very important port cities under the British.
Ma'am, Govindpur and
No, I'm not talking about the towns which made up Calcutta. There were three presidency towns, main towns of administration under the British. They were also the port towns from which
Madras.
Okay, Calcutta, Madras and Bombay, right? At that time it was called Bombay. So it was Calcutta, Madras and Bombay. These were the three presidency towns under the British. So the Woods dispatch, it said that universities should be founded, established in all these three presidency towns. Then it also said that there should be schools or institutions for training teachers and to train teachers for all types of school, different types of schools. So there should be training centers to train the teachers also. Then the government should maintain the existing government colleges and the high schools, and they should also build up new schools, establish new schools if it was necessary. So it was the duty of the British government to maintain the colleges and the schools which were already there in India, and also establish new ones if it was compulsory or necessary. Then the government should establish new middle schools. Then greater attention to be paid to the vernacular schools, indigenous and other, for expansion of elementary education. Means more stress should be given to schools which were teaching in the local languages of the people, the native schools, the indigenous schools which were set up by the people of India, and the vernacular schools which taught in the local languages of the people. So these schools should be paid greater attention so that they can spread education at the lower or the elementary or the beginners level. Then a system of granting aid should be started to support the privately owned school. Now, if the school is owned by the government, so obviously government would be granting aids and supporting the whole thing. But if it is established by a private individual, then you know, school, they also require a lot of money. And so in that case, grants and aid should be provided to the schools. Now, the dispatch, it gave greater importance or special attention to the importance of planning the means. Means they said that education should be useful and practical, and this education should be imparted to the masses in India. Education which is useful for them and also which is practical. And according to the Wood's dispatch, English was to be the medium of instruction in the higher branches, whereas vernacular in the lower. And the Wood's dispatch said that English means the vernacular languages should not be removed and English taught in its place, and but only English should be taught where it was necessary. So English should be used as a medium of instruction in the higher classes, and otherwise also it should be taught wherever it was in need or wherever there was a demand, but the vernacular schools should not be removed and English taught there. Okay, then a properly graded system of granting scholarships to the students, now it was also introduced, and the female education was to be given proper support by the government. And after the dispatch, education departments were set up, and in 1857 universities were set up in Calcutta, Bombay and Madras. So that was under the British rule. Now, what was the education system like in India before the colonial period or the pre-British India? Now, they start with a question that, have you ever wondered that how children were taught in the pre-British days? And if there were schools then, and if schools already existed before the Britishers came here, then what happened to them under the British rule? So obviously we know that school existed in India before the Britishers came here. So we will also have a look at what happened to them under the British rule. Now the information that we have about the indigenous or the local local schools here, which was set up by the local people or the Indians, now which is available to us today, it belongs to the 1820s and the 1830s. And what that information is that during that time, education was carried out basically through the Pathshalas, the Madarsas and the Gurukul. So these were the main system of education. What was the Gurukul system of education, class 8?
Ma'am, system in which ma'am Raja Maharaja's child goes to study.
Yes, anyone else? What was the Gurukul system of education? Gurukul.
Ma'am, I think there was a common teacher. There was just one teacher and he taught all the students.
Okay, but there was something, there was one teacher who used to teach all the students of various ages and all that. Yes, that is right. But what was so special about the Gurukul which separated it from the Pathshalas and the Madarsas? What was so different about the Gurukul?
Ma'am, it teaches like
ma'am, it
sacred. Ma'am, religion.
Okay, so you're saying it taught more of religious education, but you know there was something more. The students, they have to leave their houses and go and stay with
Yes,
their
ma'am.
guru at his ashram. All right, so the students, they had to leave their homes and they went to stay with their guru in the ashrams. And then the guru, normally he sat under a tree on a raised platform, and the students, they used to sit all around him on the ground, and the teacher taught according to the needs of the students. So that was the Gurukul system of education, and obviously it was based more on sacred education. So these three institutions were the source of the traditional knowledge system in India, and it played a very important role in the education system of India. And now the most well-known and decisive point, means a very good point, emerged from the education surveys which were carried on by the Britishers here under William Adam. And what he said according to his surveys, that around 1 lakh village schools existed in Bengal and Bihar around the 1830s. Means in Bengal and Bihar alone, around 1 lakh schools existed, village school existed. And people like Thomas Munro, and he also observed that every village at that time, they used to had a school. So though the schools were about 1 lakh in number, but the total number of students taught in these schools or in these pathshalas were about 20 lakh. And usually these institutions or these schools, they were set up by the wealthy people, and at many times they were even started by a guru at his ashram. Now the system of education, what was the system of education at that time? It was flexible, and there was no fixed fee, no printed books, no separate school building, no blackboards, and no even roll call registers, and no annual examination. I think most of the students of today would like it very much. What do you say? Yes, class 8?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. No blackboards, no printed books, and no annual examination. That is the main thing, right? Okay, so in some places the classes, they were held under a banyan tree. Would you like that, classes to be held under a banyan tree?
Yes, ma'am, very peaceful.
Okay, or in the corner of a village shop, and or sometimes at a temple or at guru's house. Now the fee, it depended on the income of the parents. Now, so what that meant is that the rich, they paid more, and the poor, they paid less. And the teaching was imparted orally, and the guru, he decided what to teach students according to the needs of the students. So according to the needs, education was imparted orally by the guru. Then the students, they were not made to sit in separate groups or separate classes like we have today. But instead, the students, they sat together in one place, and the guru, he interacted with them separately with different levels of learning. Now, William Adams, he also discovered that the education system was such that suited the local needs of the people. For example, during the harvest times, the classes were suspended. And why? Because the children, they needed to work in the fields with their parents, and so the classes were suspended, and the pathshala, it resumed once again when the crops had been cut and stored. And so it meant that even the children of the farmers, they could also go to the schools. So that was the system of education before the Britishers arrived in India. Now let's see, when the Britishers came to India, what happened to this whole education system? So new rules and new methods. Now up to the mid 19th century, the company, it was concerned only with the higher education in India, and therefore they allowed the pathshalas to function and they did not interfere much. But after the Woods Dispatch of 1854, the company decided to improve the overall system of vernacular education here also, and they thought that this could be done by imposing proper rules and regulations and routines, and ensuring proper and regular inspections of the schools. So how was this done? And so the government, the British government, they appointed a number of government pundits or government officials. And so these pundits, they were given the charge of going to different schools and surveying them, inspecting them. And so each pundit was given 4 to 5 schools, and they were to visit the pathshala and try to improve the standard of teaching there. Then each guru was required to submit reports and take classes according to a particular and set timetable. Then the students were taught according to printed textbooks, and learning was to be tested through annual examinations. So under the Britishers, the whole education system, it changed. And now the students were asked to pay a regular fee, attend classes regularly, sit on benches, and discipline themselves. So the pathshalas, which accepted this new system of education, now they were given grants by the government, British government, and those who were unwilling to work under the new system, they received no help or support by the British government. Now the new rules and regulations, they have other consequences also. Now in the earlier system, we read that the children of the farmers, they could also attend school, and because the timetable was flexible. But the new system, it required regular attendance, and so the children of poor families who had to work in the fields during the harvest time, now they were unable to attend school. Why? Because the inability to attend the classes, it was seen as indiscipline by the Britishers. So this is what happened to the system of education in India, which earlier existed under the British rule. This is what happened to it. Now, in the early 19th century, many thinkers from different parts of India, they felt that education should be spread to more and more people. And some Indians thought that the modern education, the Western education, it will help the people to modernize here. And so they urged the Britishers to open more schools, more colleges and universities. But there were many who were against the spread of Western education, and two such individuals were Rabindranath Tagore and Mahatma Gandhi. So let's have a look at what were the views of Mahatma Gandhi on education. Now, Mahatma Gandhi, while he was in South Africa, he was in South Africa practicing law, and at that time, while he was practicing law, the system of apartheid was prevalent in South Africa. Now, it was a system of discrimination, racial discrimination, and special to South Africa. And there, the whites, they discriminated the blacks, the native blacks there, and even discriminated the colored people there. Indians, they called colored. Okay. And so Gandhiji's experience in South Africa, it not only changed his outlook, the way he looked at politics, but it also helped to see the role that education played in this freedom struggle. And now he also had been a beneficiary, means he had also received benefits from the Western education for a number of years. And while he was in South Africa, he tried to persuade people, the Indians, to take advantage of education. However, a change came when he was in his mid-30s, that he became so opposed to the English education that he could write about the rottenness of this education. And later on, earlier he himself received Western education. He himself was a beneficiary of Western education for so many years. But later on, he became so opposed to the Western education that he said that it is a rotten language, and then rotten education. And he said that to give millions a knowledge of English is to enslave them. And according to Gandhiji, he said that if people were taught in Western education or taught in English education, that was like enslaving, making people slaves. And he said that, and that is what we have done by imparting Western education to India. We have enslaved the people there. And he was angry when he had to speak about independence in a language which was foreign language and a tongue which was not Indian. And he was also angry that he could not practice in a court of law in his own mother tongue. Now, under the British rule, the official language was English, and so all official documents were in English, and the best newspapers, they were printed in English, and education was carried out in English for a chosen few or elite Indians. Then he did not blame, so Gandhiji, though he did not like all this, but he did not blame the colonial past or the Britishers for this, because you know Gandhiji thought that it was logical that the Britishers they would like to spread their education and their values and their customs here, so that the people, a few high class Indian people, they will learn the English language and they will come to terms with and become supporters of the Western education, Western culture, their values and all that. And in this way, when they have done that, so their empire would be strengthened or consolidated here. But Gandhiji, so though he understood this point, but he blamed the Indians, his fellow Indians, that they have accepted this situation. And later on in his life, he went on to declare that real freedom will come to us only when we free ourselves from the domination of Western education, Western culture and Western way of living, and which had been ingrained in us, means which had been established in us, which has been set up in us. So we, if we want real freedom, then we have to get ourselves free from the Western education, the Western culture and the Western way of living. And according to Gandhiji, emancipation or freedom from this Western culture would mean real freedom for us. So that was the view of Mahatma Gandhi on British education, and we will have a look at it more tomorrow when we meet again. So today we will end the class here. Have you all understood? Anything which you have not understood, you can ask now.
No, ma'am.
Ma'am, what was the mother tongue of Mahatma Gandhi?
Where was, where did he belong to?
Ma'am, Gujarat.
So, what would be his mother tongue?
Gujarati.
Yes, Vaheb?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Alright. So, we meet tomorrow again. And all of you, Manal, beta, is there any problem with your connection? You are joining and leaving and joining and leaving again. Is there any problem?
No,